Good evening, and welcome to the JMU Convocation Center and to the Matazone HD Sportsnet pregame show presented by the JMU Alumni Association. I'm Brandy Sowers. The JMU men's basketball Dukes begin a three-game homestand of Colonial Athletic Association games tonight by hosting the Delaware Blue Hens. JMU enters tonight's game with a 12-9 overall record and a 5-3 league mark after splitting a pair of road games last week. The Dukes opened a four-game trip with an 82-59 loss at Northeastern last Thursday before overcoming a 12-point halftime deficit to beat Hofstra 69-63 on Saturday. Junior point guard Ron Curry was named the co-player of the week as he averaged 23 points, 5 rebounds, and 2.5 steals per game and scored a career-best 25 in the Hofstra win. Delaware has brought in tow records of 4-15 and 3-5, but three of its victories have come in its last five outings. The reigning CAA champion Blue Hens were hampered by a key injury and young personnel that contributed to an 0-10 record into early December. The Blue Hens, who won last year, Matt Brady conducted his weekly fan and press luncheon yesterday at O'Neill's Grill and let us know his thoughts on the Blue Hens.
Yeah, and they're 3-2 in their most recent five-game CAA conference schedule. And what I think has happened to them is you take Kyle Anderson out of that lineup for the first 8 or 9 games of the year, you put him back in, there's a period of adjustment, and recently, it's an explosive offensive team, and when Corey Holden gets 17 to 24 points in a game, it's a team that I think can beat anybody. So we're obviously very aware of the fact that Kyle Anderson playing at his level, Corey Holden playing at a high level as a freshman point guard, and you know, always having five guys on the court that can score, this is a team that can score the basketball. So we're aware of it, our team is aware of it, and we're going to have to continue to hold teams down, you know, defensively, and hopefully hold them into 30%. You know, I think one of the things that we know that our field goal percentage defense is good. We don't talk a lot about what we want that number to be, but when you hold a team in the 30s, you're doing what you need to do, and then you have to do those other parts to it. You have to rebound the ball. You've got to take good shots. You've got to make your free throws, which we can and can't do sometimes. But if we can hold this team in the 30% range, then we like our chances.
Delaware swept the two encounters a year ago and holds the upper hand in the series, 14-8. Coach Brady is 4-4 against his former coaching teammate, Monte Ross, who guides Delaware. The duo, when the Hawks made their 2004 Cinderella run into the Elite Eight, finishing 30-2. Let's take a look at the CAA standings. There's a three-way tie for first between Northeastern, William & Mary, and UNCW. Hofstra and JMU are tied for fourth, JMU holding the head-to-head advantage. Elon, Drexel, and Delaware are all 3-5. Towson at 2-6, and the College of Charleston back at 1-7. When we return, a look at the first-place JMU women's basketball Dukes after this timeout on Matazone HD Sportsnet, presented by the JMU Alumni Association.
Instead of asking yourself, where did those 4 years go? Think about where the next 40 will take you. Be involved at Madison. Dukes from day one, alumni for life.
I knew going to JMU would be more about just getting a master's.
I just knew that it was the place for me.
I feel as though that I'm a part of the institution.
You will never meet a stranger. Everyone is always willing to help you out and to help you through your graduate experience here at James Madison University.
The graduate school here is a great choice.
The education that you receive is top notch.
It's one of the best in the country. And from here, everything is possible.
Junior guard Precious Hall netted a team-high 20 points to lead a quartet of double-figure scorers in James Madison's 73-53 GAA women's basketball victory Sunday at the College of Charleston. The Dukes improved to 8-0 in the CAA and to 17-2 overall, tallying their 26th victory against association teams in their last 27 attempts. Hall turned in her 12th 20-plus scoring performance of the season. She made three-pointers and brought her season total to 62, the 10th highest in JMU history. She is already fifth on the all-time career chart with 162 trays. Redshirt senior center Lauren Okafor added 17 points and a game-high 10 rebounds for her eighth double-double the year. She also added four blocks, her second consecutive four-block performance. Senior forward Toya Jiggets and junior guard Ashley Perez each chipped in 10 points. Coach Kenny Brooks was also at O'Neill's Grill yesterday for his fan and press lunch and reflected back on another 2-0 week for the Dukes.
We improved a lot, you know, which is obviously our goal. We came out, you know, with a different focus, you know, starting with William & Mary. William & Mary is always a tough opponent. William & Mary, I've always said, you know, they're a win or two away from gaining confidence. They have a talented group of players. And they were coming off a very good win against the University of Delaware on the road. And we knew it was going to be a tough task. I thought our kids came out. And we've talked about getting our kids hitting on all cylinders at the same time. And Thursday night was that game. We came out and, you know, we had so many people who contributed in a major way. You know, starting with Muff Mickens, who, you know, I think had 11 assists and one turnover in that ball game, and really set the tempo. We got everything going. Precious Hall shot the ball extremely well. Lady Okafor, came out and has been dominant, you know, for the last 8 or 9 games, you know, which is very positive for us. But we also got some good bench play. I think Ashley Perez came off the bench and scored 16 points. Jasmine Guathme hit a couple threes. I think she had double figures. So it's just an all around great effort. I was very, very proud of the kids. You know, they're starting to understand their roles, and they're coming out and they're playing good team ball. And I think in that game in particular, we had 32 field goals, and I think we had 23 assists. You know, so they're sharing the basketball, they're taking up for each other, and it was a fantastic game. I thought we had a great flow. You know,
the CAA women's standings have JMU alone at top, 8-0. Drexel 2 games back. Elon and Hofstra are tied for third. UNCW and Towson 5th. Delaware in 7th. William & Mary and the College of Charleston in 8th. And Northeastern in last. In other JMU sports news, James Madison opened the women's tennis spring schedule last weekend with a pair of victories in Annapolis, Maryland. On Saturday, the Dukes claimed 5 of 6 singles matches to overcome Towson 5-2, and on Sunday, smoothly sailed past Navy 7-0. JMU senior Taylor Pinchoff and sophomore Rachel Nelson completed an unblemished weekend, combining to win both of their doubles matches and posting respective victories at number 1 and number 2 singles. Sophomore and transfer Rebecca Harris clinched the decisive fourth point in the Dukes win against Towson with a pair of 6-4 wins at number 6 singles. James Madison battled for the 4-2 men's tennis victory over Morehead State on Saturday morning at the Sports Racket in Lynchburg, Virginia. Junior Maxie Brandt posted a come-from-behind win at number 4 singles to break the 2-2 tie. After falling in set 1, Brandt posted a 6-4 win in set 2 and a 6-1 win in set 3 to take the point. Freshman Stephen Goldman clinched the JMU victory with a 6-love, 6-love decision at number 5 singles. Brandt and Goldman respectively teamed up with junior Robert Sterling and sophomore Brett Moorhead to win on the Dukes courts, leading the Dukes to a team point. Senior Sin-Hae Won claimed 2 of James Madison's 9 event victories, and juniors Camilla Zulata and Kristen Zulinski and combined for a pair of 1-2 finishes in the Dukes 167-123 victory at Richmond in swimming and diving on Saturday. The Dukes won for the 5th straight time and improved their dual record to 6-3. One captured the first of her 2 individual victories by claiming the 100 breaststroke, touching the wall in 1 minute 4.72 seconds. She paced a 1-2-3 finish in the 200 individual medley with a time of 2 minutes and 9.29 seconds, and holding off a pushing challenge by sophomore Shannon Harper, who touched in 2 minutes and 9.33 seconds. Zulata and Zielinski went 1-2 in the 50 freestyle and later in the meet in the 100 freestyle. The Dukes host their final home meet this Saturday against Campbell and Clemson at 1 p.m. The JMU track and field team ventures up to George Mason University this weekend for the Patriot Games in their third weekend of indoor competition. 2 weekends ago, sophomore Deanna Forbes set the school record in the 60-meter hurdles with a time of 8.56 seconds in the preliminary heats at the Kentucky Invitational. Meanwhile, at the Liberty Open in Lynchburg, JMU athletes won 4 events, including sophomore Carol Strock in the 800-meter run, senior Morgan Schaefer in the 500-meter dash, senior Teal Westbrook in the 1,000-meter run, and sophomore Allie Bodmer, a transfer from Virginia Tech, in the 3,000. JMU senior attacker Steph Finley has been voted the Colonial Athletic Association's Lacrosse Preseason Player of the Year, announced Tuesday by the league. The Dukes were picked to finish second in the CAA in the 2015 by the league's coaches. JMU was just narrowly edged in the vote by Towson, which has won the CAA tournament each of the last 3 seasons. Finley's honors come on the heels of being named CAA Co-Player of the Year last season, sharing the honor with Towson's Andy Raymond. In 2014, Finley scored a team-high 44 goals while tallying 15 assists for 59 points, while setting the single-season program record for draw controls with 69. Finley was also named to the 2015 preseason All-CAA team. She is joined on the squad by senior midfielder Allie Kerwin, junior midfielder Taylor Gress, and senior defender Lexi Cross. As mentioned earlier, the swimming and diving Dukes will have their senior meet on Saturday. Swim coach Dane Peterson will join us when we return after another timeout on Matazone HD Sports Net, presented by JMU Alumni Association.
If you love wings, if you love rings, and all kinds of other tempting things, great times, great food, get to Quaker Steak and Lube.
Get saucy at Quaker Steak and Lube. Feel the heat with new Sriracha Chicken Tacos, Island Jerk Chicken Sandwich, or Sweet Heat Curry Chicken Wrap. Now for a limited time.
Great times, great food, get to Quaker Steak and Lube.
There's a great place to find high-quality cars without the hassles. And it all starts here, at CarMax.
We believe that buying a high-quality used car should be hassle-free. So at CarMax, we start with a low, no-haggle price on every car.
With a great selection on every lot, you can test drive an incredible variety of cars all in one place.
And every CarMax car is protected with a 30-day warranty and a 5-day money-back guarantee.
So when you're ready to start the search for your next car, come see the way car buying should be at CarMax. Start here.
I would like to welcome swim coach Dane Peterson. Thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
So, coach, coming off of your win against Richmond last weekend, tell me a little bit about your team's performance.
Evaluating a lot of things during that performance. Obviously, we're happy to come away with the win against a very quality opponent. But at this point in the season, we're really evaluating a lot of different types of swim, seeing how our training is paying off as we kind of get ready to for our push for the championship season.
In your post-game interview, post-meet interview about Richmond, you mentioned that you realized your swimmers started off a little flat. What have you all been working on this week to make sure you start and finish strong?
Yeah, I think that was more of just kind of learning some lessons when we're on the road. We hadn't been on the road in a while. Obviously, we came back from the Christmas break, and we were at home, which was awesome. It was great to be at home. So I think it was just more learning the lessons of how to take the momentum we created when we were at home and applying it on the road. So it was more of kind of a lesson learned the hard way, and we hope to kind of learn from that when we go. The next time we'll be on the road is in North Carolina in a couple of weeks.
This Saturday, as mentioned before, is your last home meet of the year, and it's obviously your senior day. What all do you guys expect for a crowd? Do you think a lot of parents are going to be out?
I think there will be a lot of parents and family. We don't have a lot of home competitions, so this will be our second one in 3 weeks, and like you said, we get to honor our seniors, which is, you know, bittersweet. Obviously, you get to celebrate the time that they've been here, all their accomplishments, but it's also a little bitter because you're saying goodbye to some very impactful seniors. But hopefully it's a good turnout, and we look forward to a good crowd.
I understand that you actually started coaching here at JMU in 2007. How did you end up at JMU?
Maybe I shouldn't admit this, but I actually didn't know about JMU until I applied here. I'm from the South. I went to school in the Midwest, and after I finished grad school at the University of Missouri, I was looking to apply for an assistant job. JMU was there, and I came out on an interview, and then everything else, I guess, is kind of history.
Coach, I have to wonder, do your swimmers have certain superstitions or rituals that they do before meets to get them pumped up?
I think maybe individually they all probably have their own favorite song, but as a group for home competitions, we kind of all go into our locker room, into the girls' locker room, and you know, whatever messages, whatever anybody wants to say, but there's really not a lot of talking. It actually turns into just a big dance party. Our girls, they're at their best when they're laughing and kind of being goofy and having fun. So we've just got a new sound system installed in our locker room, and last weekend we found out how loud it actually can go. So they actually just kind of blast music, have fun, dance around, act goofy, and that's really kind of how we get ready to compete.
And Coach, I understand that these meets, there's also diving competitions. Do you have a favorite dive that you like to see executed?
I don't have a favorite dive. It is a lot of fun watching our divers because our divers are really good. Becky Benson, our diving coach, has done a phenomenal job. We actually both arrived at JMU at the same time. So she's done a really good job. So it's just fun to watch our divers because they're very competitive and they always do a great job for us.
And going back to this weekend, will all of your seniors be participating in the meet?
They will be. We have four swimmer seniors, and they will all be competing. I don't quite know where yet. I haven't done the lineup. That's work for me and still left to do, but they'll all be swimming this weekend.
Well, thank you, Coach Peterson. Good luck this weekend and at the CAAs.
Thank you very much for having me.
No problem. Thanks for joining us on the Madison Basketball Pregame Show. I'm Brandy Sowers. Kurt Dudley and Kyle Hightower are courtside for tonight's JMU versus Delaware clash, coming up next on Madison HD Sportsnet.
Instead of asking yourself, where did those 4 years go? Think about where the next 40 will take you. Be involved at Madison. Dukes from day one, alumni for life.
Is he still in there?
Yeah.
Sleeping in the closet every single night. This has got to stop.
Oh, hey, Elaine. How's it going?
How much longer are you going to be here?
Billy is five.
Six.
12 years. But don't worry about me. I got my pillow pet.
Tame the tuition monster. Visit Virginia529.com and see why it's the nation's largest 529 college savings plan.
Hey, what's popcorn?
Introducing something new from Old Dominion. Our clients have loved our feature-rich mobile site for years. And now you can get all that info in an app. Search the way you like. Discover listings in new ways. From desktop to mobile, we've got you covered. And one more thing, we are the only company in the area to have access to 5 MLS systems. That means you'll get more listings and info here than anywhere else. Guaranteed. Old Dominion Realty. Now that's what you are looking for.
And Telos helps every member of the family get a smartphone and the freedom to actually use it. It's 2 gigs of data with unlimited talk and text for only $25 a month. And zero down on all smartphones. Get the phones you want and save money every month. We'll even buy out your contract. And Telos, wireless for the people.
Great pass! Carlson scores! JMU Athletics and the JMU Alumni Association are teaming up to bring you this free Madison HD Sportsnet feature presentation. From Harrisonburg, Virginia, the campus of James Madison University, welcome to NCAA basketball. Tonight, the JMU Dukes and the Delaware Blue Hens. Tonight's game is being presented to you by Dick Myers Chrysler Dodge Jeep and brought to you on Madison by the JMU Alumni Association, Virginia Lottery, CarMax, Delta Dental, the JMU Graduate School, Intellos Wireless, Old Dominion Realty, Quaker Steak and Lube, Residence Inn, University Outpost, Virginia Blood Services, Virginia 529, Wells Fargo, the JMU Adult Degree Program, Blue Ridge Power Sports, the JMU Bookstore, Klein May Realty, Pepsi, the official soft drink of JMU Athletics, Virginia Business Systems, Comcast Sportsnet, and the JMU Duke Club. A warm welcome, everyone. I'm Kurt Dudley, joined tonight by Kyle Hightower. And from courtside, we'll be hearing from Autumn Morowitz and Gabrielle Smith. Well, tonight we reached the midpoint of the CA men's basketball schedule, and things are starting to take shape a bit. Tonight, the Dukes coming off an impressive 69-63 win at Hofstra Saturday host the Blue Hens, who are 4-15, but do not let that record fool you. The Hens are on the rise, 3-5 in the CAA, and 3-2 in their last five games, as Kyle Anderson has added offense while Corey Holden has run the offense. And Kyle Hightower, upperclassman, could be a very big key in tonight's ballgame.
Yep, that's right. We've got Kyle Anderson, senior from Delaware. And he's been extremely hot lately, as you just said, 23 points and 25 points respectively in his last two games. And then we've got Ron Curry Jr., JMU leader, and he's coming off his first career back-to-back 20-point outings, scoring 21 at Northeastern and 25 in their win over Hofstra.
One of the keys in the win over Hofstra, 42-36, the advantage on the rebounding category for the JMU Dukes, and that certainly means good things when the Dukes do out-rebound their opponent.
That's been big for JMU. They're 9-1 when they lead their opponent in the rebounding margin, just 3 wins when they don't out-rebound their team. And these two teams playing tonight are in the bottom half of the conference in rebounding margin. JMU 7th with a negative 2.9 margin, Delaware 8th with a negative 3.5 margin. So it's going to be big for both teams.
And if this becomes a close one, it might come down to which team is the best at accepting charity, the free throws.
That's true. We've got two very young teams tonight, and both of them sit also in the bottom half in free throw percentage. JMU 6th in the CAA with 69%, and 7th is Delaware with about 66%. So it's going to really come down to who's going to hit the free throws at the end of the game and who's going to step up. Is it Ron Curry? Is it Kyle Anderson of Delaware? So we'll just have to wait and see.
Let's take a look at the team stats, how they're going to balance up tonight. You see both teams scoring there in that 60s range. Now, interesting, JMU, when it does score between 60 or 69 points, is 4-0. An interesting statistic there. Field goal percentage favoring the Dukes, but as Coach Brady has pointed out, on the upswing for the Delaware Blue Hens, and Kyle Anderson has had a lot to do about that. Free throws, it's been on the decline for the Dukes. They were about 71% a few games ago. Rebounding, well, that too will be key, as Kyle did point out. Now let's take a look at some of the individuals in this game and how they match up as far as the numbers are concerned. Ron Curry, the CAA Player of the Week, he is the co-recipient of that this week, and Johanny Dallenbear, and then Kyle Anderson and Corey Holden. Again, Anderson, he had a broken hand early in the year, but as you'll see in some of this replay activity here, that Anderson has come back and he's provided a bit of spark to the Delaware Blue Hen as their numbers have gone up. When I talked to Monte Ross back in October during media day, he said, Kurt, we're going to have a hard time just scoring the basketball. I'm not sure that he knew that Kyle Anderson was hurt at that time, but indeed, they were lucky to get into the 50s on many occasions. But then just a couple of weeks ago, they got by the Tribe of William & Mary, getting 84 points in that ball game. So that sets you up for tonight's contest. It's the JMU Dukes and the Delaware Blue Hens. Stand by as we'll return in just a moment after this timeout. You're watching JMU Men's Basketball tonight on Madison HD Sportsnet, presented to you by the JMU Alumni Association.
Instead of asking yourself, where did those 4 years go? Think about where the next 40 will take you. Be involved at Madison. Dukes from day one, alumni for life.
visit the James Madison University Bookstore, your source for all things JMU. Get your official Duke gear. Open after every football game. The JMU Bookstore. Support the team.
Now with a full line of independent rear suspension options, the all-new Foreman Rubicon and Rancher Automatic DCT models are equally ready to work and have fun. Part of the growing ATV family from Honda.
Blue Ridge Power Sports, where the power is yours.
If you love wings, if you love rings, and all kinds of other tempting things, great times.
Get saucy at Quaker Steak and Lube. Feel the heat with new Sriracha Chicken Tacos, Island Jerk Chicken Sandwich, or Sweet Heat Curry Chicken Wrap. Now for a limited time.
Great times, great food. Get to Quaker Steak and Lube.
Welcome back. Let's take a look at the starting lineup for the Delaware Blue Hens. Here is Kyle.
We've got Corey Holden, freshman out of Salisbury, Maryland. And next up, we've got Kyle Anderson, number 13, 6'3", senior out of Newark. And then we've got number 15, Maurice Jeffers out of Washington, D.C., Calvin College, 6'9", redshirt sophomore. And then we've got Marvin King Davis, redshirt junior, 6'7", out of Richmond, Virginia. And finally, Kasman Hayes, number 22, 6'4", sophomore out of Charlotte, North Carolina.
And the Delaware Blue Hens, coached by Monte Ross, graduate of 1992 from Winston-Salem State down in North Carolina. He comes into tonight's ball game with 119 wins and 156 losses in his tenure there with the Delaware Blue Hens. There he is with his team huddled around him right now. Screened off there by Mo Cheeks, one of the assistant coaches there for the Delaware Blue Hens. Now here's the starting five for the Dukes of JMU.
And first up, we've got number 40, Yohani D'Alembert, 6'8", sophomore out of Port-au-Prince, Haiti, and Lower Marion High School in Pennsylvania. And next up, we've got number 13, Tom Vodanovich out of New Zealand. He's a 6'8", sophomore. And then we've got your leader, Ron Curry, 6'4", junior out of Pensacola, New Jersey, and Matt Brady's high school, Paul VI in New Jersey. And then junior transfer, Winston Gray, 6'2", out of Cleveland, Ohio, number 3. And finally, you've got your sophomore, 6'7", Jackson Kent, number 10, out of High Point, North Carolina.
Duke's huddling all around their starting five. Matt Brady, the head coach of the JMU men's basketball Dukes, now in his seventh season. And his 11th season overall as a head coach. Brady, 111 wins, 111 losses. And overall, 184 and 161. He's 5-4 against Delaware here at JMU. Prior to that, Delaware owned this series. Dukes were only 3-10 in the previous meetings. Of course, Delaware joining the CAA about a dozen, 13 years ago or so. And these two teams met a couple of years ago in the semifinals of the CAA tournament. Dukes won that game in dramatic fashion and went on to defeat Northeastern to win the 2013 title. And there you see the all-time series with Delaware leading. And Delaware 7-4 here at the JMU Convocation Center. Delaware, meanwhile, last year won the CAA championship and went on to the NCAA tournament, but they lost a lot of experience from that team. And when Kyle Anderson injured his wrist, was out, it certainly hampered Delaware early, but he is well back and ready to go. And he can make this team click, as can Holden. Your officials for today's game, Clarence Armstrong, Ron Tyberski, and Tim Comer, as we're underway here at the Convocation Center. The Dukes and the Delaware Blue Hens holding the basketball early. Anderson over the top they go, and the Dukes come out. They look as if they'll settle into that 3-2 zone. Anderson draws double team in the corner, and the pass is errant, goes right through the hands of Jeffers. As the Dukes will get the first shot of the night off the rim, no good on Jackson Kent's accord. Rebound for Anderson. Ball deflected by Winston Graves. Nearly saved by Ron Curry, who comes flying over the score at the press table on our side. I'm glad he was down about 15 feet.
Yeah, no, that's something that's going to be big for the JMU Dukes, is creating turnovers. They're tied for the lead in steals in 8 conference games with 7.1 steals per game.
Nearly got another swipe, and that ball knocked away by Winston Graves. So the Dukes showing a lot of activity out of the 3-2 zone already against the Blue Hens.
Yep, and that zone has been huge in NCAA play since they've switched to the zone. They've been leading, they have the second best scoring defense in NCAA.
Turnaround jumper is good, and that's popped in by Marvin King Davis, who averages 8.8 points per game, 4.8 rebounds. Delaware takes the opening lead. Jackson Kent down in low it goes. Dallenbear, Yohani, the sophomore, back out to Kent. Anderson out guarding him. Kent uses the dribble now. It's Dallenbear. Dallenbear inside the circle. That's off the mark. If you're going to take that shot, you might as well step back another foot and try to get 3 instead of 2 out of it. Kenny Brooks, the head coach of the women's basketball Dukes, and I talked about that last night, in fact.
Yeah, that's right, and that's not really Yohani's forte, I guess you could say. He's more of a back to the basket, and he gets those high percentage shots.
He does. He does want to develop that 10-foot jumper, but it's still in development, Kyle.
Yep, and that's why with his back to the basket, though, he's been so successful. He leads the CAA in field goal percentage.
Get a kick basketball by King Davis. Monte Ross's team shoots at 39%, but yields defensively 43% from the floor. And you may have heard Matt Brady talking during our pregame show this evening that the Dukes hope to hold the Blue Hens somewhere in the 30s shooting tonight. Dukes need to warm up a bit, though, as they've missed their first couple of shots. 0 for 3 early in this one. 23 on the shot clock. Ron Curry coming off the 25-point night at Hofstra. Jackson Kent, that's off the mark. And off the floorboard, rebound by Jeffers, who yanks down close to 5 per game.
And Jackson Kent there, another open look for 3. He had a good game against Hofstra, putting in 13 points for the Dukes.
Double team and the pass coming out high, but nobody there to make a quick play out of it offensively. King Davis turnaround jumper from the foul line. No good. Rebound Vodanovich, who had a career-high 12 rebounds the last time the Dukes played at home. Dallenbear with his back to the basket. Up and under. Can't get it to fall. Rebound King Davis.
Yeah,
no, that's Jeffers. My apologies.
There's more of his forte right there. He just couldn't get it to go.
Well, dry spell to open things up for the Dukes. But they're doing a good job of at least going to the glass. Here's Curry all the way, uses some contact, and he'll score for JMU. Curry averaging 11.5 points per game. He averaged 23 points in the 2 games up in the northeastern regions of the CAA last week. I'm just glad the Dukes got out of Boston before the storm came through.
That's true. We had a heck of a lot of snow. And we'll look to see JMU play a lot more through Ron Curry, as we've seen the last 2 games. And he's got 7 straight games with at least 10 points. So we'll see if he can continue that streak tonight.
2-2. Kind of a grinded out offense to start things off here tonight, which I guess, Kyle, kind of keeps that in that 60-point pace possibly.
Yep.
Jackson Kent trying to get going early. Poliashotkas has come in. He'll try the 3. It's off the lip. And the Dukes now 1-for-6 shooting. The good news is Delaware just 1-for-5. Make that 1-for-6 now. Vodanovich with his second board. Curry down the court. tried to drop it up. Shotka said turn, anticipating the shot.
Yeah, it hasn't been the cleanest game so far. A lot of sloppiness and missed shots. We'll see how that pans out.
Kasman Hayes with it, a sophomore from Charlotte, North Carolina, out of Philip O'Berry. Holding into the corner with Hayes. Vodanovich out there, gets him up in the air, turn around. That's in and out. Offensive rebound, and the stick back is good for Maurice Jeffers.
And that's also going to be a big part of this game is the offensive rebounding. Delaware coming in with about a +3 offensive rebounding margin over the Dukes. Delaware averages about 10.4 rebounds per game, and JMU just about 7.5.
There's a deuce for Jackson Kent, his first two. He averages 10.3, and we're tied at 4-4. Duke's putting some pressure on, and that takes a little bit of air out of the basketball on the offensive set. 15.5 to go here in the first. Kyle Anderson with a long range. Wow, well off the mark, but coming up with the basketball is King Davis, and he will score the ball on the offensive putback. So second chance points favoring the Blue Hens on that occasion. Timeout on the floor here at JMU's Convocation Center as the Dukes trail 6-4. Now, we told you a little bit about Kyle Anderson, but the guy that's making an impact here for the Delaware Blue Hens is one Corey Holden, and more on Mr. Holden with Autumn Morowitz. Hello, Autumn.
Hi, Kurt. He's definitely making a humongous impact. He's a 6'2 freshman point guard for the University of Delaware. He's hailing from Salisbury, Maryland, and he has just received his third Rookie of the Week, CA Rookie of the Week honor, excuse me, which is not very surprising if you know the past week he's had. Last Wednesday, when the University of Delaware was at William & Mary, he led the Blue Hens with 24 points in the amazing comeback win where they won 84-80. And this past Saturday, in the unfortunate loss against Elon, he put up 12 of his own points. Now in the CAA, Holden is currently running second with 4.5 assists and seventh with 34.2 minutes played per game. He's also ranked ninth with 1.4 assist to turnover ratio, and he also has 13.4 points per game. With those unbelievable numbers, Kurt, it is not surprising that he is setting himself up to be a very promising candidate for CAA Rookie of the Year. What do you guys think?
Well, I think he certainly is a big candidate, along with Elijah Brooks down at Elon. They kind of seem to be the 1-2, and you know, we're at the midpoint of the season. You can take a look at their numbers and compare them, and it may be determined in the next 9 games.
That's very true. Yeah. Elijah Bryant down in Elon has had a huge game or huge year himself so far, minus the game against JMU where we held him pretty quiet.
Yeah, that was probably one of the few games where he did not have much of an impact. And certainly he'll get another chance to shine in front of the Dukes when the Dukes travel to face Elon during the second half of the season. Well, it's chilly outside. It's equally chilly in here as far as the shooting is concerned. JMU 2-for-8, Delaware 3-for-10. And at the free throw line, completing the three-point play is Marvin King Davis. He is a Virginia native out of Richmond, went to Meadowbrook High School. 66% free throw shooter, and he collects that one. On the hardwood now for the Dukes is freshman Joey McLean out of Greensboro, North Carolina. Here's the other Greensboro area product, Jackson Kent. He steps into a tray, and he now has 5. Kent with his first three-pointer of the evening, and that gives him 37 on the year as he is shooting at 42% from three-point range. And we're tied at 7 apiece. Kabarski Corbett, also a 6'7 freshman from Tampa, Florida, now in the lineup. Anderson, and you see how quickly he can get rid of the basketball, hits his 33rd three-pointer of the year. He shoots at 37% accuracy from beyond the arc.
Yep, he puts it up quick, and he puts it up at a lot. He's shot at least 5 threes every single game he's played in, the 12 games that he's played in thus far this year.
Behind-the-back pass, nicely done. Vodanovich can't finish it, but he will get to the free throw line on the behind-the-back pass. That's a pretty nifty move by Jackson Kent. Hopefully we can see that one again. Personal foul on Maurice Jeffers. That's his first team foul, number one, and there's the nice behind-the-back pass. Vodanovich needs to go up on 2 feet and finish that strongly.
And this is going to be JMU's almost make or break. They're going to need to hit their free throws. As you said, they really haven't shot the free throws or shot free throws well in CAA play. And after they had a really good start to the season, shooting at 72% or so, they've really dropped off in CAA play, only about 68-69%.
The trainer for Delaware taking a close look at Kyle Anderson. Looks like they're taking a peek at his left eye. You can see him right there at the edge of the baseline at the corner. That's the trainer in front of Anderson as Vodanovich hits the first of two free throws. Vodo now on the board. He's a 60% free throw shooter. And the Dukes with an offensive rebound. JMU trailing 10-8. Vodanovich fakes the three. He took a three the other day at Northeastern. And folks weren't too pleased about that one, but they can be with this one. Jackson Kent has 8 of the Dukes' 11, and the Dukes have their first lead of the ball game.
And he's really shown a lot of confidence these last three shots, just putting up as soon as he gets it. And I'm pretty sure he swished 2 or 3 of those shots.
Down inside Pinkert, he does check in, and he pops one home. Devon Pinkert, a 6'6 sophomore from Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Not too far from the University of Delaware. They're in Newark. Here's Shotkus. He's isolated. Jackson Kent, they feel like he's got the hot hand, still looking out for the sophomore. Down low it goes. Shotkus, nice ball fake, and he'll put it up and in. Good patience.
And Shotkus, he's not one that's going to put up a bunch of points, but he does all the little things right. As we saw him find a wide open Kent, and then they set it back up and got a wide open look for him down low, and he converts.
The lead yo-yoing back and forth. The Dukes back out in front, 13-10. 12, that is. Hayes, Holden still in the lineup. And as Autumn mentioned, 34 minutes per ball game. He doesn't take many breathers. That is a three-pointer in the corner for Corbett, who hits his 28th tray of the season. He's a 33% shooter. I'll say if you can shoot 33% from three-pointers, you're a pretty darn good shooter. Winston Graves on the curl, gets his own rebound, and loses the handle as he was triple-teamed there below the cylinder. And we get a foul on Maurice Jeppers. That's his second personal.
And JMU's going to really have to take advantage of those offensive rebounds. They don't get a whole lot every game. They only get about 7. And, I mean, fortunately, they were able to create a turnover there with the foul on the Blue Hens.
Both teams with a couple of turnovers here. About 8 minutes into the contest. Winston Graves can shoot the three. Dallenbear isolated, will drive, bumps, drives, spins, up and under he goes, and scores it.
I couldn't tell from here if that went high off the glass or if he just arced it over and in, but good job by Dallenbear.
He found his way somehow. And we're tied at 15 apiece. Well, the pace of scoring has picked up just a slight bit here after a very slow start.
Yep, we've got Delaware hit their last 4 field goals and JMU's 5 of their last 6.
And the Dukes nearly come up with a turnover, but Joey McLean will get called for reaching in, and that is the first foul against the Dukes of JMU. 11:36 to go in the first half. James Madison 15, Delaware 15. Back with more after this timeout. You're watching JMU Men's Basketball here on Madison HD Sportsnet, presented to you by the JMU Alumni Association.
If you love wings, if you love rings, and all kinds of other tempting things, great times, great food, get to Quaker Steak and Lube.
Get saucy at Quaker Steak and Lube. Feel the heat with new Sriracha Chicken Tacos, Island Jerk Chicken Sandwich, or Sweet Heat Curry Chicken Wrap. Now for a limited time.
Great times, great food, get to Quaker Steak and Lube.
I knew going to JMU would be more about just getting a master's.
I just knew that it was the place for me.
I feel as though that I'm a part of the institution.
You will never meet a stranger. Everyone is always willing to help you out and to help you through your graduate experience here at James Madison University.
The graduate school here is a great choice.
The education that you receive is top notch.
It's one of the best in the country. And from here, everything is possible.
Welcome back, everyone, to the JMU Convocation Center. Kyle, is that a buddy of yours, do you know?
I have no idea who that is.
All right. Well, we're glad they're here, as we're also happy to have the Delaware Blue Hens in town. Now, this is the ninth game of the CA schedule. First time the Dukes are facing the Blue Hens. They still have to face UNCW. That'll be a week from today. They have already finished off their in-season, regular season series with Northeastern, as that rattles out for King Davis.
King Davis, he's been hot for Delaware as of late, averaging about 10.5 points and about 6.5 rebounds over his last six contests.
Now, with having Kyle Anderson in there, that certainly changes strategically what teams can do against Delaware. So his presence probably does assist in others, upping their game a bit, which is one reason you do see their scoring numbers going up a bit as well. Johanny Dallenbear with an illegal screen for JMU. There's Monte Ross. We actually have a tangled web between these two benches here tonight, and we'll learn a little bit more on that in a few moments from Gabrielle Smith. She will untangle it for us. There's Anderson. Floater, no good. Rebound, skied for, pulled down by Ron Curry.
And oddly enough, Curry's been one of the better rebounders for the Dukes over the last few games, averaging five, six rebounds.
A nifty floor move by Curry. He was looking for the screen for Shotkus when it wasn't needed. He rolled on to the rim. Down inside, low block. Corbett's got one three-pointer already. Anderson gets rid of it in a hurry. Curry harassing Pinkard. And the three-pointer, it's good, yep. Corbett with his second.
It almost seemed that was a little bit lucky right there. He just kind of threw it up as the shot clock went down.
Off the rim and a rebound pulled in by Corbett. That's his first of the night. Delaware looking to extend the lead off the rim for the Dukes. The rebound, Winston Graves into the hands of Curry. Well, this isn't a run and gun game. It's very just one side court to the other side of the court at a leisurely pace. Joey McLean well off the mark. Dukes now 7-for-16 from the field. So are the Delaware Blue Hens. Somebody forgot Corbett out there. And he now has 9 as he has hit 3 trays. And Matt Brady wants to call a quick timeout. Well, this does begin a 3-game homestand for the Dukes tonight. They'll be back in home action on Saturday against the Tribe of William & Mary. You want to see a good player, Marcus Thornton, coming in.
Yep.
He can light it up from anywhere.
Yeah, he is a heck of a player. He shoots over 40% from three, and that's just ridiculous.
I think he's an NBA bench player. I don't think he can't play but so many minutes, I think, in the NBA, in my opinion. But a team that can afford to have him deep on their bench, because he can bust a zone in a hurry, and, of course, they're playing man-to-man in the NBA. But still, he can crack the lid in a hurry.
Yeah, he could definitely be one of those spark plug players that comes off the bench and hits the key three for you, especially because he can create his own shot so well.
It doesn't take much space for Thornton to hit one, and then the Dukes finish that 3-game homestand next week against UNCW. Dallenbear gets it in the paint, kicks it out. Curry, high pass, near side. Kent, shot clock is down to 18, so still some time to work with on this possession. Gray's find his way. Now he'll kick it out. Three-pointer for Curry. Rims around, tapped out. Into the hands of Jackson Kent. Graves, contact, and he gets it to tumble in after he bumps with Anderson.
And Curry already 0 of 3 tonight from 3, but over that two-game road trip, he was really hot, 8 of 11 from 3 in the two games against Hofstra and Northeastern.
You know, Ron, like a lot of players, if they get an early shot, a good shot early, can kind of lubricate the offense, and sort of like the way Jackson Kent has done so tonight. Fouls on Dallenbear, that's his second. That becomes an issue.
And we've known that Ron Curry is really one that can, if he really wants to, he can just turn it on and score as many points as he wants to, but he likes to be that floor general and lead the offense, which is why he's third in the CAA in assists.
Marvin King Davis picks up his seventh point, and Delaware opening up the 23-19 lead. Tom Vodanovich comes back in, and young man Dmitri Kabarkaba, 6'10 redshirt sophomore from Serbia, had his most significant impact on the Dukes game on Saturday. He scored 5 points. He had a three-pointer, and he had a big offensive putback, offensive rebound and a putback for the Dukes in significant playing time in the second half.
Yeah, I saw that three that he hit against Hofstra. It was one that probably took about 5 seconds to finally go down into the rim.
That's about where he shot it from right there. That time it's off the rim, off the heel of the iron. Rebound fought for, and Pinkard comes away with it. UNCW leading Elon tonight. 8 minutes in there, 17-5. That ball blocked by Curry, tracked down by Corbett. Shot clock, still plenty to work with. Anderson far side, it's no good. Rebound, Chabarkova. Northeastern leading at Drexel, 10-7. William and Mary leading at home against Hofstra, 24-13. That's a key game. And Charleston is at, the College of Charleston is at Towson tonight. They're towards the bottom of the league. So probably the most significant game tonight in the rest of the league play is Hofstra and William and Mary. Vodanovich tries a three-pointer. The Dukes are now, they're taking a lot of threes, Kyle. They're now 2 for 10 on trays.
Yeah, but that's really not Vodanovich's shot either. He's more of a, if he's going to score, it's going to be pretty much off an offensive rebound and a putback, or he drives the lane. He's not much of a shooter. And he probably shouldn't have taken that shot right there, to be honest.
Dukes are 2 of 11, I should say, as they are now 18% from beyond the arc. Corbett tries another tray, and it's good. That is his fourth of the game. And we have an injured Delaware Blue Hen on the floor.
Yeah, I didn't see what happened right there.
Not sure, but the injured player is Barnett Harris. Like he may have got kneed or something of that sort. And we have a timeout on the floor, 7:16 remaining in the first. 27-19, Delaware's opened up a lead. Back with more after this timeout on Madison HD Sportsnet.
My experience with Glenn and May was amazing.
Our agent was very helpful through the whole process.
There was investment into our interest, more so than just trying to quickly get to a sale.
You know, he's not only my agent, but my friend.
I felt very much like family. Really was very well taken care of and very, very pleased with the entire experience.
Welcome back to the JMU Convocation Center. Delaware 27, JMU 19. These two coaching staffs know each other, oh, so well, don't they, Gabrielle Smith?
That's right, Kurt. You may recall the Cinderella story from the St. Joseph men's basketball team during the 2003-2004 season when they were led by Naismith College Player of the Year, Jameer Nelson. The Hawks went 30-2 that year and went on to the Elite Eight until they were defeated by number 2 Oklahoma State. The coaches here tonight have actually greatly contributed to St. Joe's success in the past. In fact, JMU head coach Matt Brady was the former assistant coach for St. Joe's from 1993 to 2004. As well, Delaware's head coach Monte Ross was also an assistant for St. Joe's from 1997 to 2007. But the connections don't stop there. JMU assistant coach Bill Phillips played for St. Joe's in 2001 and 2002 actually alongside Delaware's assistant coach as well. So the connections have non-stopped for these two coaches here tonight, and they're back on the court coaching for the CAA. That's all. Back to you, Kurt.
Thank you very much. Yes, it is a tangled web of former St. Joe's Hawks. They were coached by Phil Martelli, senior, and Phil Martelli, junior, is on the coaching staff. And there you see the JMU coaching staff. Coach Phillips, he's the tall one in the middle, by the way. Of course, he coached there. And then the Philadelphia connection continues with associate head coach Rob O'Driscoll on the far right chair there. He was at Villanova as he went to school there for the Wildcats, or with the Wildcats. Dukes all of a sudden down by 8, Delaware. Finding some open threes as the Blue Hens now 5 for 12, 41.7%. And they're shooting 45% from all points at 9 for 20. Meanwhile, the Dukes 40%, 8 for 20, but 2 for 11 on threes. Yep. Shot clock down to 8. Graves finds his way into the paint and finds his way for his second field goal of the evening.
He seemed to be up in the air for a couple seconds there, but was able to get the shot up over Corbett and a nice bucket for the Dukes.
Gray's averaging just under 9 points a game. Down low, Markaba will get whistled for a foul, I do believe. Yes, that is on him. And that is the first on Dimitri. And the third on the Dukes as a team. And once again, we see the free throw shooting skills of one Marvin King Davis. He's got 8 points. His career high 18 came against the Bryant Bulldogs in December of 2013.
This is already his fourth time at the line tonight, getting there in bunches.
And he comes up with yet another. He's the first in double figures. He has make that the second in double figures. He's had to earn it a little bit step by step, whereas Corbett has launched the 4 3-pointers. Kabarkaba tries another three. That's good.
Kabarkaba got a wide open look right there, and the assist from Ron Curry, already his second of the game.
So for the first time in Dimitri's career, he has hit a three-pointer in three consecutive games.
And hopefully he can continue to spark the Dukes offense, especially with a three-point game.
Actually, Dimitri's career high is a mere 6, and it came against the Delaware Blue Hens.
Yep. And that was, I think, in the CAA tournament last year.
Vodanovich.
Or rather, their last CAA matchup against Delaware, sorry.
The Dukes and the Hens did not face each other in the tournament last year. Delaware did sweep the series last year. And the three-pointer gets the Dukes a little closer at 29-26. Good ball movement around the perimeter. And there's another tray, this one registered by Kasman Hayes. That's his 36th of the year, and he has taken well over 100.
Yep, and they're just stroking it from three right now. They're already 6 of 14 on the three-point shots.
Vodanovich with a turn. So Bodo gets into the action. He's got 5 now. And the Dukes trail by 4.
I mean, that's more his shot right there. He took the 3 in the corner earlier. Not really his forte. But got the easy 2 right there.
Well, that's an easy jumper, but well off the mark. Here comes Graves of the Dukes. Curry bumps, finds his way to the glass.
And that's really where he's at his best, is driving the paint, making contact, and just making the defender have to try and defend him without getting fouled, and that's where he's good using his body.
Vodanovich, another rebound for the Dukes. JMU with a chance to tie or take the lead. Curry will try to go for the lead. And the rebound comes down to Corbett. By the way, Corbett's 4 3-pointers, a career high. He had hit 3 3-pointers 4 times in his career.
There's definitely room for more tonight, as we've got plenty of time left to play.
3:40 to go here in the first half. Anderson down low. King Davis. And he'll score it again. King Davis now with a dozen points. So he and Corbett sharing game-high honors. 34-30. Gray's looking for the screen. Floats it up. Gets a favorable fall.
And that's a shot that Gray's likes to take a lot. He likes a little floater in the lane.
He has definitely learned how to play among the bigs.
That's true. And he's also, for his size, he's a great rebounder. He's averaging about 3.5 rebounds per game.
That just means to me he's got a nose for the basketball.
Exactly.
He does. Many times he may not necessarily secure the basketball, but he might keep it open, keep it alive. Vodanovich had the angle, saved by Curry into the hands of Kabarkova. And we get a foul called against the Blue Hens. I didn't see it, yeah, but there was quite the reaction from the crowd. King Davis picks up the personal. That brings us to our final media timeout of this half. The Dukes trail by two, 34-32, here on Madison HD Sportsnet, presented to you by the JMU Alumni Association.
Introducing something new from Old Dominion. Our clients have loved our feature-rich mobile site for years, and now you can get all that info in an app. Search the way you like. Discover listings in new ways. From desktop to mobile, we've got you covered. And one more thing, we are the only company in the area to have access to 5 MLS systems. That means you'll get more listings and info here than anywhere else. Guaranteed. Old Dominion Realty. Now that's what you are looking for.
The Residence Inn by Marriott provides guests with plenty of room. Room to recharge. Room to prepare. Room to relax. Stay one night or as long as you like. The Residence Inn by Marriott provides each guest with amenities tailored to their individual needs. Spacious suites with all the comforts of home. Because it's not just a room, it's a residence.
Well, if you'd like to join us here at halftime, we don't have a whole lot going on, so we do invite you to send us an email here. There is the email address. If you're a fan of the Delaware Blue Hens, you're also welcome to shoot us an email this evening. No matter where you may be watching from around the globe, always like to hear from folks. Always curious to know where you're watching from and who you might be rooting for, whether it's the Dukes or the Blue Hens. And sometimes we get people that are rooting for the pep band when they write in. You just never know.
We do have a great pep band, that's for sure.
You know, we were up in Boston last week, and Chris Brooks and I, we got there 24 hours before the Northeastern game. So Chris has a buddy that's the sports information director for ice hockey at Boston College. So we went to see Merrimack and Boston College play, and the BC band was there. Can you imagine taking the pep band of JMU and put it with an ice hockey team?
That would be incredible.
It would be unbelievable. I can imagine the energy that would be at that facility or at that particular game. The club ice hockey team here is actually pretty good. They beat Virginia the other day in sudden victory. And a three-pointer. Launched up and in by Jackson Kent. He's the first Duke in double figures. He has 11.
And Kent's really been the only one that's been feeling it from three-point range, 3 of 5 so far. Knight and the first JMU man in double figures.
Kent went 2 for 3 against Hofstra. And here tonight he is 3 for 5. Kent will grab the rebound this time for the Dukes. McLean has come in, finds Vodanovich, who is bumped by Kyle Anderson. Anderson picks up his first personal foul. Team foul number 4. This has been a very clean half in terms of fouls, and usually when that happens, the half goes by quickly, and that has been the case. That was kind of an excuse me there on Anderson's case. Kent draws attention from not one, but two Blue Hens. Shotkus powers his way. loses the basketball. And Joey McLean knocks it free. And that will go to Delaware as it was last touch by Paulius Schottkus.
You know, Schottkus' arm right there just kind of in the wrong place at the wrong time as they were as Delaware was trying to clear it out.
Got a sub coming back in. Here comes King Davis.
Well, we also saw Joey McLean there. That's really what he comes in to do is be a little pesky on defense. He likes to get his hands in the way of the guards, which creates a lot of steals for him and the Dukes.
Anderson will drive. He gets it to the rim. Can't get it to tumble in, though. Rebound for the Dukes. Curry shovels the pass right side. Jackson Kent. There's another for Jackson.
And he is just feeling it right now. After missing his first two shots, he's hit his last five, including four of those being threes.
He made 5 3-pointers here at home against High Point a little over a month, actually 5 weeks ago. And he has the Dukes out in front, 38-34. Another miss. King Davis, that was point blank.
And that's been a big reason why JMU's leading right now. Their defensive rebounding has been very good today, unlike most of their contests so far this year.
Dukes lead on the glass, 19-13. Kent gets fouled by Anderson. Yes. That's two on Kyle Anderson. So he has two, and Maurice Jeffers two, and the Blue Hens have just five.
That one really could have gone either way because it looked like Kent nearly extended his full arm, but I guess the ref didn't see that.
Kent takes the inbounds from McLean. What that does, too, the Dukes can run it down to the final shot.
Well, I'd say look for them to try and get it to Curry or Kent, who's been hot.
Looking for the screen. McLean kicks it out. Vodanovich pulls up and scores it. The bucket does count. Indeed, it does. Not who we anticipated taking the final shot of the half. But the Dukes, they put up 40, and they lead 40-34. And even though the Delaware Blue Hens shot the ball very well early in the contest, they end up the first half shooting 38%, maybe a little higher than what Coach Matt Brady wanted. But they are in the 30s, as he was hoping for. And the Dukes do have the 6-point lead, and they were trailing by a considerable. They trailed by as many as, I think, 8 in the first half. And they've got the 6-point lead here at halftime. JMU 40, Delaware 34. We'll take a quick break as you're watching JMU men's basketball tonight here on Mattazone HD Sportsnet, presented to you by the JMU Alumni Association.
We all know the importance of continuing your education, whether completing a degree or seeking professional development. Are you thinking about your next step? JMU's adult degree program is designed to create opportunities for adults to pursue an undergrad degree that fits their lifestyle. If completing your degree is something you've been wanting to do, JMU Outreach and Engagement can help you achieve your goal. Call today to learn more. Whatever your next step, JMU Outreach and Engagement is with you every step of the way.
Telos helps every member of the family get a smartphone and the freedom to actually use it. It's 2 gigs of data with unlimited talk and text for only $25 a month. and zero down on all smartphones. Get the phones you want and save money every month. We'll even buy out your contract. And Telos, wireless for the people.
Welcome back to the JMU Convocation Center. Kurt Dudley, Kyle Hightower, Otto Morowitz, and Gabrielle Smith courtside here at the Combo. JMU finishing off the first 20 minutes of today's ball game with a 10-0 run over a stretch of the final 3:16. In fact, the Delaware Blue Hens, their last bucket came with 3:35 to go. They missed their last four field goal tries, one of their last seven and two of their last nine. Meanwhile, for the Dukes, they finished going 4-for-4 to end the half and lead it presently 40-34, Kyle.
Yep, and a big part of that 10-0 run was Jackson Kent, who hit two threes and really caught fire there at the end. And Vodanovich, a nice touch to end the half with that little floater in the lane. And we also had Curry, who had a monster first half with the not so much with the three-point game, but was 3 of 7 from the field, 6 points and 3 rebounds and 3 assists, so good all around.
Once again, the email address that if you're interested in joining us here tonight, we'll give you a shout-out, and we'll put that email address up there for you once again. And we'll wait just a little bit to see if any do come in this evening. Mattazone@jmu.edu. Fan of the Blue Hens, fan of the Dukes, send us an email here this evening. Kyle and I are just going to step aside for about 5 minutes or so. We'll be back. We'll check our email bag. We'll take a look at our first half stats, and we'll replay some of the highlights of our first 20 minutes tonight here on Mattazone HD Sportsnet, presented by the JMU Alumni Association. Don't go away. We'll be back in just a few. Free. 34 lead, using a 19-5 run to close out the first half of play. The Dukes trail at one time 29-21. Delaware kind of spurted out to that lead, and then the Dukes all of a sudden looked up and JMU was leading. It happened very abruptly there. Kyle, what do you see numbers-wise?
Numbers-wise, you would think JMU has a much bigger lead than they do right now. They've shot 56.7% in the first half compared to Delaware, just 37.9. But Delaware also had the 6 free throws made to just one by JMU. But looking at some of the stats, especially for Delaware, JMU's really kept in check their top two scorers, Kyle Anderson and Corey Holden. Kyle Anderson with just the 1 3-pointer. He's got 3 points, and they've held Corey Holden scoreless, but he does have 3 assists. And then for Delaware, you've got Chavarsky Corbett, who hit 4 of 6 threes. He's got 12 points and 4 rebounds, so he's been big for them. And then Marvin King Davis, he's been getting himself to the line, 6 of 7 from the line. He's got 12 points and 2 rebounds. And then for JMU, you've got Tom Vodanovich, who had a heck of a first half with 7 points, 6 rebounds, a block, and a steal. And then Ron Curry and Winston Graves, each with 6 points, 3 rebounds, and 3 assists. And then Jackson Kent, obviously we saw he got really hot. He had 14 points on 4 of 6 from 3, 5 of 7 shooting overall, and he had 3 rebounds. And a big thing, JMU just 5 of 15 from 3. We saw they started off pretty poorly, but Jackson Kent really helped that out. They were 12 of 15 from 2-point shots, which is very impressive on their part. So those are some of the stats, especially, and they ended on that 19-5 run, which is very impressive as well.
19-5 the run. They lead it at 40-34. We did get a number of emails, and the first one came in from a Pep Band fan. Not a surprise there. Definitely hoping the Dukes win tonight, but our son Josh Boyles is a trumpet player in the Pep Band, so our loyalties are divided. They're not divided. It's a win-win situation, as far as I'm concerned. What about you, Kyle? Wouldn't you think so?
I would think so, yeah. Basketball, Pep Band.
That's
what
right.
What more can you ask for?
We got a handful of others. We'll try to get to these other emails here from Holly and Randy Castelli. Their class, Holly is a class of 79, I assume, Ron. Randy may be as well, watching from London, England. So we've got it tuned in across the pond there. Good job there, folks. Glad that you're watching here on Madison tonight and that the Alumni Association can bring it to you. Our good buddy Alex Reese, hoping to be here on Saturday for the Dukes game against William & Mary. Let's follow up with a huge win after the huge win against Hofstra. Playing for a lot of the marbles against William & Mary. And thanks always, he says, to Kurt and the crew. That's Alex. Alex has been to a couple games already this year, at least the one I do recall that he was here at the combo. Some other emails. Scott Brown asked a question. Hari Hall, is he injured? Yes, he is. He's been banged up a couple of things, ankle, ever since right before the Drexel game up there. He's been banged up, I think, an ankle at one time and knee at another time. So he just is not at full health. But we did have some JMU fans watching from London, England. We have some Loonpin fans watching at 2 o'clock in the morning from Hamburg, Germany. Heather Johnson, Delaware class of 2015, so she must be studying abroad to finish up her collegiate career.
That's a dedication right there, staying up until 2 in the morning.
Yeah, the only people I know that do that on a regular basis are people in the military or soccer fans.
Yeah, exactly.
Soccer fans like to do that quite frequently. Got another half minute here before we resume our action. And one more. Okay, watching up in New York. Also playing at Hofstra on Saturday, Peg Cassidy. Watching in Lake George area of New York State. Right, thanks, guys, for emailing us here tonight. We'll give everybody a shout out here. That's the Dukes with the advantage, 40. Delaware sending out its crew. Corey Holden, Kyle Anderson, as Kyle Hightower mentioned, those two didn't do a lot offensively. So if you're Delaware, you say, hey, we put up 34 points in our top two guns. We've only put up 3 points, and that might bode well for the Blue Hens in the second half. They're joined by Kasman Hayes, Maurice Jeffers, as well as King Davis. The Dukes, they'll go with Jackson Kent, Ron Curry, Tom Vodanovich, Winston Graves, and Johanny Dallenberg. Dallenberg saddled with a couple of fouls in the first half, so he was somewhat limited in minutes played because of that. He'll get started right away, pushes the shot in for the score.
There's a quick start that Jamie is definitely looking for. They're looking to get quick, score quickly and score often in the second half because they really haven't had someone that's been willing to step up. I mean, Ron Curry did a great job against Hofstra, but we'll see who it is here tonight if they want to win in the combo.
Curry was 6 points in the first half. And Kyle Anderson, or excuse me, King Davis, rather, picks up points number 13 and 14 on the evening. Open three, Jackson Kent. That's his fifth. Is that correct? That's his fifth, yes.
And he stays hot. He's, after missing those first two shots, made his last six. Impressive numbers for Jackson Kent.
And that ties his career high that he set against High Point on December the 20th of this season. Curry, nobody there to defend, leaves it down low for Vodanovich, and he'll draw contact. Tim Comer making the call. And we'll see a couple of free throws. On the way is Kasman Hayes picks up the foul. That's his first.
JMU taking off right where they left off from the last half. They've made, dating back to the last half, their last six shots.
Kent now with 17 points, 5 of 7 on threes and 6 of 8 overall. And Vodanovich has 8 now. And Eric Carter, a 6'9 freshman from Jackson, New Jersey, Jackson Memorial, just averages 2 points, but grabs about 3 rebounds a game. And Delaware looking to just simply get some boards and get some possessions. Dukes up by 10. In and out. And that ball bounded around a bit, but controlled by the Blue Hens. Holden kicks it out. Anderson, right wing. That's a throw.
They're going to need him to get hot in order to come back in this second half. Only 3 points in the first half, but looking to score early.
Dallenberg goes up to slam it, and he'll get contact. And Johanny will go to the free throw line.
And this is where JMU needs to convert here at the free throw line.
I think Coach Brady, he's been really preaching to these guys to go up with 2 feet. And you can finish it. Dallenberg trying to finish it instead at the free throw line. He gets a favorable roll. Johanny with 5. He averages 11 points a game. Here's Coach Brady. Johanny from Port-au-Prince, Haiti, hits them both.
He's got a pretty free throw shot. shoots around 70%. He was a little bit better at the beginning of the season, dropped off a little bit, but hopefully he can get back up into the 70s here soon.
He had that tough finish against Elon when the Dukes had a substantial lead, and it got whittled down because the Dukes turned the ball over a number of times and failed to hit free throws down the stretch.
And if I remember correctly, he was only about 4 of 10 or so in that game.
I think he missed 5 in a row. You know what he did later that night? Came out and shot free throws. That's a three-pointer for Kasman Hayes, his second. Blue Hens now 8 for 16 on trays. So they're back over 40% shooting in the ballgame. 50% from the arc. Jackson Kent, backdoor cut. Winston Graves finishes it. Winston has 8.
And he's had a solid all-around game. He's got the 8 points, 4 rebounds, and 3 assists, so he's doing it all over the stat sheet.
Dukes already to 50. Now I mentioned in the open that when the Dukes are between 60 and 69 points, they're 4-0. It doesn't mean that they can't win with more than 69 points, and they have done so. Corey will get called for the foul as he reaches in, makes some contact. And Curry picking up his first of the night. That's on the floor, so no free throws coming to the Blue Hens. Over the top it goes. Eric Carter comes away with it. Holden with it. 4 assists for Holden, so he's well on pace of his season average of 4.5. Backdoor cut. Anderson blocked by Dallenberg. Rebound tracked down by Curry. Curry quickly down the floor. Leaves it down low. Laid up by Johanny Dallenberg.
And he's really coming out strong this second half. 4 points already. And a block.
That's a timeout called on the floor by the Delaware Blue Hens. We'll keep it right here.
There's the block, or the block from Johanny. He's done really well so far in CAA play with the block shots. He's second in the league, in league games with nearly a block and a half per outing.
Well, that for Dron Curry is his 6th assist of the ball game. So he has 6 points and 6 assists. Interestingly, when he scored the 21 and the 25 last week, I think he only had 2 total assists last week. So his game can fluctuate one way or the other. Tonight he's not scoring the point, but as you mentioned, he does like to distribute the basketball quite a bit. And I always think if he just gives you a good floor game, the points will come to him if he does everything else on the floor. And he's really taking ownership with this team. There was a nice article this morning in the Daily News Record about Ron taking ownership with this club.
And he really has, especially with the departure of Andre Nation. He's really had to step up and be that guy for them to go to. And we saw in the last 2 games that he's really willing to score at will. But tonight he can be the distributor if he wants to, and that also allows for him to score points if he needs it, because people are going to think, oh, he's just going to try and dish it off to someone. But he's definitely capable of going to the lane, getting that easy bucket, or pulling up the three like we saw this past week and him going 8 of 11 from the three-point range.
Marlett standing by. We'll chat with her in just a short while too. I saw Duke Dog had a date there in the stands. Kelly Moore. Duke's getting some pretty good. You have the 17 points for Jackson Kent, by the way. That's just 1 point off of his career best, which he has hit 18 points on 2 occasions. 8 from Vodanovich, 8 from Dallenberg, 8 from Grain, 6 from Curry. I think the last home game, the Dukes had 3 players in double figures, and then 3 with 9 points apiece. Anderson, that's a 2-pointer. He stepped on the line.
And he's coming out hot right now for Delaware in the second half. He's already hit 2 shots to put him up to 8 points for the game.
Just the 3 at intermission. Curry. As Delaware in the man-to-man, holding on him. Graves comes out to meet the pass. Dallenberg in the paint, loses the handle, spins, turns, and shovels it in. Dallenberg has 10 points.
He's right already seen him make a couple baskets like that, just trying to twist and turn until he can get a little seam, and he puts it up.
Basket by King Davis.
King Davis answers it the other way. Davis with 16 now. Off the mark, rebound Holden. Holden running out of the pack. Kicks it out right side. It looked like Hayes slipped on the floor and ran into the contact of the Duke's defender, which was Jackson Kent. And now timeout on the floor here at the JMU Convocation Center. As the Dukes with the 54-46 lead. While the spring sports season just around the corner, including the final season with Spanky McFarland as the head coach of the Diamond Dukes. More on the Diamond Dukes. Here's our diamond, but not in the rough, Autumn Horowitz. Something just to talk about courtside basketball games.
Exactly.
Here's Hayes at the free throw line. He now has seven. He wins the cup. Rebound nicely pulled in by Eric Carter. And he'll get bumped and fouled by Tom Vodanovich. He picks up his second foul. Devon Pinkert has come back in for the Blue Hens. He played substantial minutes in the first half wearing number 11. And the slam put down by King Davis, who is at 18, and that ties his career high set against Bryant.
And that was a nice move right along the baseline there and just had an emphatic slam. No one could really stop him there.
Duke's lead has been cut down to five. There's Graves on the left wing. Vodanovich looks inside. Three-pointer well short for Jackson Kent. Rebound falls into the waiting arms of Eric Carter. Holden takes it down, drives it in, scoops it up. A little too much on the shot, and rebound on the weak side. Vodanovich, he loses the handle for a minute, but tracks it down with no Blue Hens in the area. Curry turns the corner, needs some help. Shotkus. Graves down low, left post. Kicking it back out. Curry to Graves. Graves gets the screen. Delaware very active defensively here in these last couple of sets. Curry back out to Vodanovich. And Cotto with a three.
Like you said earlier, it's not really a shot, but if the shot clock's going down, you need to put it up. You got to. And luckily there, he was able to hit a nice three-pointer.
Bodo hits his first three-pointer of the season. That makes him now 1 for 11.
Oh, there you go. Exactly. Not his forte, but take it as you can.
To the rim. Two short misses. Rebound again by Carter. And a foul called against the Delaware Blue Hens. A little hooking move by Carter. His second personal foul, team foul number three. Both teams with three fouls now.
With Vodanovich's three there, he's the third Duke in double figures. And hopefully this time he can get his first career double-double, because last time he was short on points, not rebounds, but hopefully he can get that, get at least three more rebounds and get his first double-double.
Fadeaway shot, Kabarkova. Decent looking shot for Dimitri. Rolled off the rim. Pinkard drains a three. That's his 22nd of the season.
30-second timeout.
And the Dukes taking a 30-second timeout. 5-point lead favoring Madison.
Matt Brady must have seen something there on defense that he didn't like. Figured he'd have to call a timeout, get it set back up, set up the offense. Hopefully they can get a good look here.
Well, Vodanovich reaching double figures for the second time this season. Mahoney Dallenbear hitting double digits for the 14th time. And Jackson Kent for the 13th time. I would not have been surprised if this was about the score with about 5 minutes left in the game.
Yeah, I have to say with just a couple minutes left. I mean, they started off, both teams started off poorly offensively, missing a lot of shots, but since then, both have been on point.
McLean drives. He got a nice ball to the rim. Can't get it to spin in, though. Holden kicks out. Pinkard just hit that three-pointer. Defense! 13 minutes to play. Pinkard tries for another try, and he hits it.
Great boy, Pinkard.
And he's starting to feel it. Him and Anderson this half. And King Davis really carrying the offense.
Well, it looks like, you know, Delaware has some players that they have their patches of scoring. You go back to Corbett with his career best 4 3-pointers in the first. King Davis was pretty steady in the first. Vodanovich too strong. Rebound, Dallenbear goes back up, misses again. Dallenbear gets it again and kicks it out to McLean. Jackson Kent in the paint, leaves it for Vodo, who lays it in.
Good offensive rebounding there by the Dukes, especially something that they really haven't had much of this season. But they've already got 6 offensive rebounds here tonight, which has been really big for them.
Kent picking up his second assist, Vodanovich with 13 points. That's a season high. His career high 15 came against Virginia last year in the season opener over in Charlottesville. Holden trying to heat up here as well, as he'll draw some contact. Will they count that? And it will count.
That was like an NBA continuation call right there.
Holden's first bucket of the night. It comes with 11:51 remaining in regulation. '59-57, timeout on the floor. You're watching JMU men's basketball here on Madison HD Sportsnet, presented by the JMU Alumni Association.
And Telos helps every member of the family get a smartphone and the freedom to actually use it. It's 2 gigs of data with unlimited talk and text for only $25 a month. And zero down on all smartphones. Get the phones you want and save money every month. Willing to buy out your contract.
and Telos, wireless for the people.
Place to find high quality cars without the hassles. And it all starts here at CarMax.
We believe that buying a high quality used car should be hassle free. So at CarMax, we start with a low, no haggle price on every car.
With a great selection on every lot, you can test drive an incredible variety of cars all in one place.
And every CarMax car is protected with a 30-day warranty and a 5-day money back guarantee.
So when you're ready to start the search for your next car, come see the way car buying should be at CarMax. Start here.
Duke's up by a deuce, 59-57. 11:51 to play. And Holden going to the free throw line to try to complete a three-point play on the Joey McLean second foul tonight. Left-handed shooter off the rim, no good. Rebound, last touched by Vodanovich. Pinkert will inbounds. Delaware with the chance to tie it up or take the lead. Couple of freshmen at each other. That one blocked initially by McLean. I think Yohani Dallenberg got involved with it too. Jackson Kent behind the back pass. It comes to McLean here on the corner looking for the screen. He gets it from Vodanovich. And a foul on Jeffers as he jumped out, kind of lost his bearing. And that's a third personal foul on Jeffers. We had a very clear shot. That was right here in front of our broadcast location.
JMU's going to want to keep this lead. They're going to want to try and get it inside.
Missed by Jackson Kent. That's only his third three-point miss tonight. He's hit five.
In Delaware, they've really stuck in this second half so far by their three-point shooting. 4 of 5 from three-point this half, 10 of 19 for the game.
That's off the mark. Rebound pulled in by Curry. That's five boards. He'll kick it out to Jackson Kent, who's off the mark. Rebound by Dallenberg back to Kent. Kent drives, wraps it inside to Dallenberg, who powers it up and tumbles home.
There's a tight look there from Jackson Kent. Had a little bit of room to work with him. Was able to fit it in. Yohani puts it up and in.
Well, Yohani's showing that when you get it down inside, he's going to try to go power to you. And why not if he can blast through and at least get some contact? Short popper, no good. Rebound McLean. On the floor goes Corbett. He's up now coming down the floor. Dukes have numbers. McLean, Dallenberg didn't anticipate it. Spin move. He does draw contact.
Would have had an easy bucket there had he caught it. Hit him right in the numbers. Almost as in football, but he'll take the free throw shots.
Watch it here. And the foul was on Jeffers, which is his fourth. Had a couple of situations tonight where the JMU forwards anticipating a rebound opportunity as opposed to a pass from their guards. All right, so Jeffers will head out. Back in comes Hayes. Who else checked in? Well, there's King Davis again out on the floor for the boys in blue. And Dallenberg back to the free throw line. He goes 0 for 2 this time after going 2 for 2 earlier. So the lead remains at 4 for the Dukes. Here come the Blue Hens. Knocked away by Curry, but regathered by Holden. And a foul on the floor. Number 4, Joey McLean picks up his third. Fifth team foul against JMU. Both teams now with five fouls. And King Davis back to the free throw line. He's been making some hay there. He's 6 for 7.
Yep, he's nearly made a home there. He's had almost, actually over half their free throws. Only one other person has two free throw attempts, and then Holden with the one after the and one, but King Davis getting himself to the line a lot.
He has now established a career high. Previously at 18. At the moment, he has 20. And the Dukes lead by just a deuce. Graves on the wing. Shotkus is out there now for the Dukes as well. He'll take a dribble, gives it up to Curry. McLean down low. Shotkus drives, spins, gets to the rim. Ball tapped out, and a foul called against Vodanovich.
Not exactly sure what the refs saw there. It looked like he got it pretty clean, but refs call otherwise.
I think he reached across the face possibly and made some contact there. And once again, Delaware with the chance to tie it up or take the lead with 9:27 to go. Delaware led by as many as 8 in the first half. The Dukes used a 19-5 run to close the half. JMU built out a 10-point lead on a couple of occasions. Ball knocked away. Last touch by the Dukes. Ron Curry looking up, trying to connect with Shotkus. Down low it goes, and a power move. King Davis adds to his career best. He's got 22, and we're tied at 61.
Yeah, King Davis has really been a force down low for Delaware tonight, taking advantage of JMU's interior defense.
Dukes have gone a little cold here lately. They're now 2 of their last 10. As Winston Graves misses that opportunity. Kyle Anderson gets his man up in the air. Perimeter movement, Holden, stolen away by Curry. Here's Ron, slams it in.
Great defense there from the Dukes, closing in on everyone that had the open pass. And then Curry just reading the passing lines and knocking it away and finishing it off with an emphatic slam.
Well, he just sat back there like a cornerback waiting for the quarterback to put it out in the flat. He picks it off and sends it home, and the answer the other way by King Davis, who now has 24.
And King Davis quiets the crowd right there.
King Davis now with 24 points on 8 of 15 shooting. All of those inside the 2 points. Tied at 63. Ron Curry can't get it to fall. Anderson comes up with a rebound for Delaware. Holden will try a three. It's good from Anderson.
If you're JMU, you don't want Holden to get hot because he's definitely capable and he can score in bunches.
He has just 5 tonight. Delaware has its first lead since late in the first half. McLean. Dukes continue to stay cold.
And the Dukes, they're going to need to get back to their bread and butter, which is getting the ball inside. Looks like they're bringing Yohani back in. And I'll look to attack that paint when he comes back in.
Anderson from the corner. Dukes recognize him there. 3-point try, no good. Rebound, Graves will screen out Anderson to go track it down. Hayes down low in the corner. Joey McLean from the corner. First bucket of the night for the freshman. We're tied at 66 with 6:33 to go.
And he likes that corner three. He's hit quite a few of them so far this season.
McLean with his 12th three-pointer during his rookie campaign. Anderson has to track it down after muffing the pass. Pinkard back to Anderson. 12 on the shot clock. Number 13 makes a move. Holden down in low. And that is on the floor, I do believe.
Yeah,
Paulius Schottkus getting a good talking to by the official. Timeout on the floor here at the JMU Convocation Center. And as we were talking a little earlier, it is coming up on the spring sports season. We told you a little bit about baseball. Now with a team that actually opens up this weekend, women's lacrosse. Here's Gabby.
Thanks, Kurt. After losing an unbelievably close game in the CAA championship last season, the JMU lacrosse team is determined to set out to finish what they started last year. The Dukes lost 12-11 with a golden goal by Towson University, giving the Tigers an automatic bid to the NCAA tournament. The Dukes are currently ranked number 2 in the CAA by the league's coaches poll, narrowly edged out by Towson, who has in fact claimed the CAA title each of the last 3 seasons. Nonetheless, head coach Shelley Baucom, entering her 9th season with the program, is determined to take her team to the NCAA tournament, despite the fact that they have not made an appearance since 2010. But take that all away, because the team is charging the CAA early on. Senior attacker Stephanie Finley was just voted as the 2015 preseason CAA Player of the Year. She also earned a spot on the 2015 All-CAA team, joining her with 3 other teammates, Allison Kerwin, Taylor Grease, and Lexi Cross. The team is set out for their first matchup against number 2 at nationally ranked the North Carolina Tar Heels at Chapel Hill on Sunday. That's all. Back to you, Kurt.
All right. Thank you very much. Best of luck to the JMU Women's Lacrosse Dukes facing the North Carolina Tar Heels to open up the season on Sunday. Some other scores around the CA. William & Mary leading over Hofstra. That game in Williamsburg, 61-48. 12.5 to play there. 10.5 to play in Drexel, and the Dragons leading Northeastern 38-37. And UNCW pulling away from Elon. That at UNCW, 55-38. The Seahawks will be in town next Wednesday night.
We've really seen so far in the CAA that anyone can win any game. There hasn't really been a team to stand out and just beat anyone. Like, we saw William & Mary lose to Delaware just last weekend, and they come in and thump Northeastern, and then JMU can't quite pull it out at Northeastern. They get beat pretty bad against them, and then they go on the road and beat Hofstra, who's been tough.
King Davis has been tough tonight, as he now has 25 points. With every point he makes, he just expands upon his career best evening. Vodanovich grabs the rebound for the Dukes. That's now 8 boards for Vodo, so he's 2 away from a double-double tonight, which would be the first in his career. Ron Curry pops up, hits the foul line, extended for 2, and asks for a foul. He's got 10.
And that's his 8th consecutive game now in double figures.
So Curry with 10. Kent with 17. He's been on that number for a while. Vodanovich 13. D'Alembert with a dozen. Vodanovich leading the Dukes with 8 rebounds. That dropped in by Pinkard. Used his height inside the lane. He's now in double figures with 10. Joining King Davis and Corbett, who's been silenced here in the second half, but he had 12 in the first. D'Alembert spins up and under, and a foul.
Now we've got 4 Dukes in double figures, and when that happens, they're 5-1. So it'll be interesting to see how this one plays out.
D'Alembert at the free throw line on the Marvin King Davis second personal foul. And D'Alembert now has missed 3 in a row after hitting his first 2.
Yeah, and we don't want a repeat of Elon here tonight.
As you mentioned, Kyle, in the open, who's going to hit free throws in the second half? You know what? There haven't been a lot of free throws in this game, relatively speaking. He now has 13 as D'Alembert hits that one, but the Dukes 5-10. Delaware 10-14. Well, nearly thrown away. I didn't even see Hayes standing in the corner. Anderson, soft touch. He's now in double figures with 10.
So now each team's got 4 in double figures. A lot of distributive scoring.
A foul on the touch. King Davis picks up number 3.
That's big over over the last few minutes here. Maybe try and have Yohani get physical with King Davis, get another foul on him, have four, and see if Delaware needs to take him out for a few minutes, which would really be helpful for the Dukes considering how dominant King Davis has been here tonight.
D'Alembert will try to complete the three-point play. Oh, excuse me, it's a one-and-one. Beg your pardon. Thank you. Kind of lost my train of thought there for a moment. Unfortunately, Melissa gathered it for me and put it right back up on the tracks. 71 apiece. King Davis. Here comes Anderson off the screen. In and out, no good. Rebound Curry. Big possession now for JMU with 4:20 to go.
In these last few possessions, we've really seen Delaware try and get Anderson open so he can get hot. Couldn't convert there, though.
Looking for the screen. Kent gets it, drives, spins. Makes a tough shot at it. Can't get it to fall. I'm not sure what Brady will think about that one. Anderson, a little too strong. And the Dukes come up with a rebound. Is trying to put it back was King Davis. He was too far under the cylinder. Skip pass comes near side. Curry. Curry, the junior, wisely gets it inside. Vodanovich, strong move, score the bucket.
Tom, nice. A nice back to the back offense there from Tom.
For Vodanovich, that ties his career high set in his first JMU game with 15. And the Dukes recapture the lead on the Vodanovich score. As the Dukes get two from down under. And take it on top, 73-71, 3:31 to go. Timeout called by the Delaware Blue Hens. It's a 30.
And now we've seen both Tom Vodanovich and Dalmir both match their career highs, 15 from each of them. Oh, sorry, not Johannes, but Vodanovich. Dalmir still looking to match his career high tonight, and he's on his way there.
A lot of the Dukes back in November when they had all those home games, they were trading off career highs. Winston Grays goes for 20, Yohani goes for 20. They were all in individual games as they were establishing them. But Winston Grays gets 20 against Longwood. Yo-Yo got 20 against Colgate.
Big thing is going to be for Tom Vodanovich to try and stay out of foul trouble. He's already got three. Don't want to pick up your fourth. Him and King Davis both on the floor right now with three. So look for either team to try and get physical down low and get their bigs in trouble.
I beg your pardon. Vodanovich's 15 points came against San Jose State last year. I was thinking it was the Virginia game. So shame on me. Holden goes into a crowd. Rebound. Up and in. Pinkert. And it falls. Tied at 73. Jackson Kent still on 17 points. Elevating. Curry, yes, and one.
He got the shooter's roll right there if I've ever seen one.
And the first personal foul called on Corey Holden. Team foul number 8. We've got a free throw for Ron Curry. He'll try to make it a three-point lead. 2:53 yet to go here on Madison HD Sportsnet, presented to you by the JMU Alumni Association.
Great pass! Carlson scores! Virginia Business Systems delivers fast-forward document solutions to help JMU Athletics build the teams they need to win. With over 7 offices and over 70 employees in Virginia, we strive to deliver the best in digital document technology. VBS innovation takes our clients to new levels. But we're not just a proud supporter, we're also a Duke Club member, and we're owned by 2 JMU alums. Go Virginia Business Systems.
You can't keep putting it off.
Hey, I overheard your other issue. You know we can take care of that too.
You do prostate exams?
Yeah, it's the same thing, just for cars. We'll bundle it. It'll be cheaper.
I like cheaper.
Pretty much the same isn't the same.
It's cheaper!
Want the facts? Learn more at thatsthetruth.com.
Pepsi is the official soft drink of JMU Athletics. Our next Matazone production is just a couple of days away. The JMU women's basketball Dukes entertaining the Phoenix of Elon. Kim Fucci will join me for our Friday night action here on Matazone HD Sportsnet. Ron Curry at the free throw line looking to complete a three-point play on the foul by Holden. And he does. Curry with a baker's dozen. Duke's up by 3. Just under 3 to go.
And those free throws are going to be crucial down the stretch here.
Well, you said that in the first half, and that's too easy. King Davis, 27 points. Dukes are 13 of 26 in the second half here, 3 of 7 beyond the arc. Delaware now 16 of 30 and 5 of 9 on three-pointers. D'Alembert, he's up to 17.
That's what you got to do. You got to attack King Davis down there because he's not going to want to foul. He's already in foul trouble. So look for them to try and get it to D'Alembert more, who's got a great ability to back down and put the ball in the hoop.
Duke's looking for a defensive stop here. Pinkert down low. King Davis, fouled by D'Alembert. That's a third on Yo-Yo. Well, at least he made sure that he was not going to get the shot up.
Yep. And I think he thought he got ball, but you can see there, he definitely got some arm in.
We got the cross arm action. So two shots for Davis. It's at 27, make it 28. 10 above his career best. And that tumbles in for him. 29 points for King Davis. Pinkert will come out. Maurice Jeffers with 4 personal fouls. Back in the lineup for the Blue Hens with 2 minutes to go and a 1-point ball game. Every possession crucial now. Dukes have both their point guards in there. Jackson Kent. Gets the man up in the air. Shot is going to be way short. Rebound pulled in by Holden. Kent got an open look. Holden will drive. And timeout. Monte Ross.
My guess is that Delaware is probably going to try and draw up a play here for Kyle Anderson. Try and get him open. Or try and get it down low to King Davis. One of those two. Because those have really been the hot hands here in the second half. Davis down low, just dominating, and Anderson's been able to get off screens, get open. He's hit a couple shots here in the second half, and he's the leader of this team. So look to get to either one of them two, and then JMU's really got to shore up defensively and make sure they don't let that happen.
Dukes are accustomed to playing some tight games with the Blue Hens. Of course, these two coaches know each other very well, as described earlier. You go back, the last couple of wins for the Dukes against the Hens were one-point decisions. One was on a last-second alley-oop on an inbound play, and then beating the Blue Hens 58-57. Three-pointer, no good. Rebound, D'Alembert. Dukes maintain the lead after the miss.
Look for them to try and run it through Ron Curry here, maybe get him open.
He's got the ball in his hands now. Curry looking for a screen, looking for D'Alembert. Needs some help. He'll get it to Yo-Yo. Yo-Yo on that right corner. Shot clock down to a dozen. D'Alembert works it out. Curry. Curry will drive, kicks it off. Vodanovich lays it in.
And that was a great dribble drive there by Curry. Dribbles, drives into the paint, and finds a wide open Vodanovich, and he lays it in nicely.
Delaware has been good from beyond the arc. 11 of 24, tries the two-pointer, no good. Rebound, Kent. 37 seconds to go. And a foul in the backcourt. Holden will foul Joey McLean, who will go to the free throw line, 1-1, as that is the ninth team foul, the second foul against Holden.
It looked like Curry was getting on McLean there a little bit because he wasn't trying to hurry the ball up the court, trying to create Delaware to make more time for them to take off the clock. But they got the foul called, and McLean's a good free throw shooter.
And he hits that one, although it rattles in. McLean has four. The lead is four.
And he's now 13 of 14 on the season from the free throw line.
A little smoother for McLean, who has five. And the Dukes up by five with 34.3 seconds to go. Three-point shooters for the Delaware Blue Hens. Holden one for two. Pinkard two for six. Anderson two for five. And Hayes two for five. Corbett four for six. All of those coming in the first 20 minutes.
Yep, Corbett really hasn't seen a whole lot of playing time here in the second half. And that could be, just the fact that Pinkard's played really well this half. Anderson had a couple buckets. And then you got Kasman Hayes and King Davis. Obviously, you're not going to take out of the game how hot he's been.
King Davis, what a line here. 29 points, 9 for 16 from the field. He didn't try any three-pointers. 11 for 13 at the free throw line, 7 rebounds. I don't know what's his problem. He doesn't have any assists.
I know. Well, that's because he's been their entire offense down low. He's been great getting himself to the free throw line and converting. He's been their best free throw shooter tonight.
Duke should put a little bit of pressure in the backcourt just to get the clock started, and Joey McLean will be at the high top of the arc. He'll put a little pressure on Holden. As the inbounds comes to Holden, he'll start the dribble right away. Now McLean will drop back. Dukes in a zone. And Holden bounces it right off the baseline as he was anticipating a cut for Kyle Anderson.
Yep, he was looking for that cut to Anderson, but Anderson was looking to get out in the corner for a three. And just a bit of miscommunication there.
That is only the 10th turnover of the game.
Of the game,
of
wow.
Of the game. Five apiece.
That is pretty crazy.
Inbounds, here's McLean. He'll get pushed from behind right away by Holden.
Yep, and that's who JMU wants at the line. He's 14 to 15 now in the season. And, if he can continue what he did the last time at the line, that's exactly what the Dukes are looking for. Especially since during CAA play in the last 10 to 15 games, they haven't been extremely solid from the line.
That is team foul number 10, so McLean will get two chances here. 6 points for Joey. Career high 10 came against East Carolina.
And it's especially big for JMU if you can have a freshman come on and be the guy that you want at the free throw line at the end of the game.
Does it again. Seven for Joey. 24 seconds. Duke's up by seven. That ball was deflected. Last touch by Jackson Kent. JMU with three players with 17 points. Here's the inbounds. Holden launches a three. That's good. Corey Holden with his second three-pointer. He now has eight. That stops the clock with 17 seconds to go and a four-point lead.
It looked almost like from here that he got a tip of the toe on the line, but the ref behind him signaled three.
They're going to take a look at it across the way.
And if they do take a look at it, I could definitely see them possibly changing it.
We'll take a look here. Ooh, that was pretty close. He may have slid right into that line. He's going to slide back. That angle's tough to see. Yeah, you can't tell from that angle.
I mean, if we could just have an angle from, like, right where I'm sitting, I've got a perfect view of right there, straight down from me, but.
Well, I tell you what, we'll put a GoPro on your head the next game. How about that? We'll see everything Kyle sees.
There you go. But I don't think, yeah, I was about to say, kind of like the NFL where you can't confirm the call, so you're going to have to go with the it stands as it is.
Well, four-point lead for Madison, 17 seconds remaining. Boy, how big is that turnover from Holden to Anderson now, the intended play there.
Yep, it really changed it because it made it from that five-point game to a seven-point game, and they needed that three there, and luckily Holden hit it. But JMU maybe try and look to get it to Joey McLean again to put him back on the line.
Of course, you never know. You extract that play out. You never know what's going to happen
anyway.
But that was an empty possession for Delaware.
And you've got Winston Grace, who can move the baseline since there was a made bucket.
Gets it into Curry. Curry will get fouled by Holden. Holden didn't think it was quite worthy of a foul yet. It just eats about a second and a half off the clock.
They really wanted to get it to McLean there, but, I mean, Curry's a viable option, though. He hasn't been great from the free throw line this year, only about 67%. But he's made the one free throw he's taken here tonight.
Yeah, completed that three-point play here in this half. Good. 14 for Ron. King Davis back in for Delaware as Barnett Harris checks back out. Barnett Harris played down the road there at Fishburne Military Academy, not very far from here. Curry, again, I heard one of the fans cheer up there. Got me laughing. Put back King Davis. 31 points for number 21. And a foul right away.
And that's someone that Delaware doesn't want to send to the line. He's an 82% free throw shooter.
That's a second foul on Hayes. And Jackson Kent will have a chance to match his career high and exceed it.
And you figure if he hits both of these, it's nearly a dagger.
There's a career high for Jackson Kent. Third time he's hit for 18. Monte Ross. And there is a career high for the JMU sophomore. 19. Holden tries a three off the rim. Jackson Kent with a rebound. The Dukes will win this one. The final here at the Convocation Center. The Dukes, they get very good balanced scoring. 19 for Kent, 17. Vodanovich, that's a career high. Dallenbear, 17. Ron Curry with 15. And the Dukes with their 13th win of the season. More importantly, they stay up in the upper bracket of the CAA as they make the turn in the conference with a record of 6-3. I think Coach Brady will take that. 88-82 our final. Kyle and I will be back to wrap things up as Coach Brady, a few fist pumps up the ramp here at the Convocation Center, and another victory for the Dukes of JMU. Back with our post game right after this timeout. You've been watching JMU men's basketball this evening on Madison HD Sportsnet, presented by the JMU Alumni Association.
Is he still in there?
Yeah.
Sleeping in the closet every single night. This has got to stop.
Oh, hey, Elaine. How's it going?
How much longer are you going to be here?
Billy is five.
Six.
12 years. But don't worry about me. I got my pillow pet.
Tame the tuition monster. Visit Virginia529.com and see why it's the nation's largest 529 college savings plan.
Hey, who wants popcorn?
Welcome back, everyone, to the JMU Convocation Center. The Dukes with the triumph, 88-82. Kurt Dudley and Kyle Hightower with you, as well as Autumn Horowitz and Gabrielle Smith. Well, Kyle, in this one, the Dukes, they found themselves down by eight there late in the first half. But JMU ends up going on that 19-5 run, taking the lead at halftime, 40-34. Delaware finds itself down by double figures, but the Blue Hens battle back, and we see the game go back and forth a little bit. You mentioned in the open importance of free throws, and that certainly kept Delaware at bay in the final couple of minutes.
Yep, JMU really converting on their free throws late in the game. They made their last eight with McLean hitting his four free throws, Kent hitting those two right there at the end, and Curry converting that and one, and then had those two free throws right there near the end. So they did a great job, went 16 of 21 tonight for 76%. So big for them, and they really did a good job tonight of distributing the ball. The eight assists from Ron Curry, four from Winston Grays, and three from Jackson Kent. They had 17 as a team, and Delaware also did a good job. They had 17 assists as a team as well.
And looking at trying to find Ron Curry with the eight assists. Now, we talked in the middle of the game about how oftentimes when he scores a lot, he's not necessarily assisting a lot, but today he got pretty good balance, wouldn't you say, coming up with the eight assists here this evening. And that ties his season high that he had against High Point, one shy of his career high that came against William & Mary, the next JMU foe. The Delaware Blue Hens end up shooting 45% from the floor, 29 of 65, 12 of 27 on three-pointers, a healthy 44%. So the Dukes win despite not holding Delaware into the 30s for shooting. Main reason is the Dukes end up shooting 54% today as they go 32 of 59, 15 of 29 in the second half after 17 of 30 in the first half. Three-pointers, 36%, 8 of 22, 5 of 15 in the first, 3 of 7 in the second. And at the free throw line, 16 of 21. And at one point, they were 5 for 10 at the free throw line.
Yep.
And so they do close out at the line very well here this evening. Points and rebounds for everybody. Maurice Jeffers, he was hampered by fouls tonight. He finishes 2 points and three rebounds. Marvin King Davis, a career-high 31. He also grabbed 8 rebounds, 8 points and 4 boards, and 8 assists for Corey Holden. Kyle Anderson, a relatively quiet night, 4 for 11 from the field, 2 of 5 on three-pointers, 10 points, 2 rebounds, 3 assists for Anderson. Kasman Hayes, 10 points and 7 points and a rebound, 12 points and 4 rebounds for Corbett. Eric Carter, no points, 3 rebounds, 12 points and 7 rebounds for Devon Pinkard. And that's it for the Delaware Blue Hens. For the James Madison Dukes, scoring and rebounding, 19 points for Jackson Kent. That's a career high. He grabs 5 rebounds, has 3 assists tonight. Vodanovich, a career high, 17 points, 8 rebounds. Johanny D'Alembert, 17-4. He also had 2 blocks. Pretty good in 21 minutes. Ron Curry, 15 points, 7 rebounds, 8 assists. That's not a bad line for the reigning CA Player of the Week. Winston Grays, 8 points, 6 rebounds, 4 assists for Winston. Jackson Kent, the 19-5, as I mentioned. Joey McLean, 7 points, 4-4 at the free throw line down the stretch, 2 rebounds, 1 assist. Shotkus, 2 points and a rebound. And Dmitry Karbakaba hits a 3-pointer for his 3 points. He also grabs 1 rebound. Dukes now 13-9, 6-3 in the CAA. Delaware now 4-16, 3-6 in the Colonial. Kyle and I will be back for a final word after this one last time out here on Madison HD Sportsnet, presented to you by the JMU Alumni Association.
The Residence Inn by Marriott provides guests with plenty of room. Room to recharge. Room to prepare. Room to relax. Stay one night or as long as you like. The Residence Inn by Marriott provides each guest with amenities tailored to their individual needs. Spacious suites with all the comforts of home. Because it's not just a room, it's a residence.
Well, Kyle, one of the things that may have separated these two teams on a Wednesday night, the Dukes are now 4-0 on Wednesday.
Yep.
What else can you look at to try to decide how this game separated? You did mention that out-rebounding, Dukes are, what, 9-1 coming in?
Yep. So they're 10-1 now. I was just about to say that they did the three key things I was talking about early on. Ron Curry, he stayed hot. He had the 15 points, 7 rebounds, and 8 assists. They out-rebounded 36-33. And proved to 10-1 in that standpoint. And then they knocked down their free throws at the end of the game. So they did everything that we asked of them to do.
Very good. They should listen to you more often.
I know.
You know, if they did that the other 9 games they lost, maybe they'd be undefeated right now.
Exactly.
And they'd be having a Cinderella season. Who knows? Duke's next outing will be at home on Saturday afternoon, actually, a 4 o'clock ball game. Brian Reese will join me for that one. He cheered from the stands here today.
Yep.
I think he got a lot of FaceTime with our camera work down on the baseline here today. And he'll join me on Saturday. Our next broadcast actually will be on Friday night. There you see the upcoming men's basketball games. That should actually be William and Mary at the top, not the Pride of Hofstra. They'll play William and Mary here. Wait a minute, what is that? Is that women's? That seems like, I think that's an old one. Something's not right there. But anyway, actually, it's supposed to be William and Mary at the top there, not Hofstra. They come in here on Saturday night. And then our next, there you go, next Madison broadcast, William and Mary there. And then coming up, let's see here, we do have the women's game on Friday night against the Phoenix of Elon. And that, of course, we'll have Madison HD Sportsnet video for that one. Our pregame show will begin at about 6:35. I think we have Aaron Mordhorst on the anchor for that one. And you can join yours truly and Kim Fucci courtside here for that ball game. Kyle, good win tonight for the Dukes.
Yep. And season high 88 points for the Dukes. And it was a big win tonight, especially since their next two games here at home are against very tough opponents, 6-2 UNCW. And I'm pretty sure they also won tonight to improve to 7-2. And William and Mary, they just won tonight as well. So two teams that are 7-2 in the CAA. So definitely a big win tonight. and gives them some confidence going into the weekend and their next two home games against tough CAA foes.
Well, they came into tonight tied for fourth with Hofstra, so Hofstra, a loser tonight, drops to 5-4, so that solidifies the Dukes' position a little more there. Of course, JMU does have the tiebreaker at the moment with Hofstra, but they still have to play the Pride one more time, but that's just something to consider there. Some folks we'd like to thank that helped to bring the ball game to you here this evening on Madison HD Sportsnet. First, the men's basketball sports information director from the University of Delaware, Kevin Tritt. Chris Brooks here at James Madison University. Want to thank him for his help. And also our floor director tonight, making her floor directing debut, Amy McAllister. Thank you very much, Amy. And she'll be back again this weekend. Our executive producer was John Salem. Also thanks to our anchor on the sports desk tonight, making her debut here on Madison as well, Brandy Sowers. And thanks to our director tonight, Taylor Mickleberry. He's a man of all trades and skills. He goes behind the mic or behind the camera or up behind the main director, pushing all the main buttons, and to the rest of the camera crew here from Telemedia Productions this evening. Also, thanks to our sponsors, including tonight's game sponsor, which was Dick Meyer's Chrysler Dodge Jeep here in Harrisonburg. Also here on Madison by the JMU Alumni Association, Virginia Lottery, CarMax, Delta Dental, the JMU Graduate School, Intellos Wireless, Old Dominion Realty, Quaker Steak and Lube, Residence Inn, University Outpost, Virginia Blood Services, Virginia 529, Wells Fargo, the JMU Adult Degree Program, Blue Ridge Power Sports, the JMU Bookstore, Klein May Realty, Pepsi, the official sports soft drink, that is, of JMU Athletics, and Virginia Business Systems, Comcast Sportsnet, and the JMU Duke Club. For Kyle Hightower, Autumn Marowitz, and Gabrielle Smith, I'm Kurt Dudley. Our final score once again tonight, JMU with the triumph, 88-82 over the Delaware Blue Hens. Good night, everyone. From the JMU Convocation Center, this has been a Madison HD Sportsnet production presented to you by the JMU Alumni Association. Good night, everyone.